Just as I began to speak about this overview, this wood chip chipper suddenly started up.
Look to see if it's possible to succeed at this.
we simply a priori insist it has to be done. So we cannot question whether it can be done or not. That's taboo. That is taboo here. So to even begin on the spiritual path, you have to break this all-encompassing taboo here, which is simply to question, hey, can we separate a dream from the dreamer? Is that even possible? And then another question is it even advisable? Or is that what we really want, actually? So there's some fundamental questions that have to be asked. And the world has these incredible taboos against even asking these questions at all. So if you wonder, why hasn't there been more success in this world reaching some sort of true happiness, securing true happiness, because of these taboos? Very few people are willing to break these taboos, because then you feel like you've done something very unacceptable to the world, and you feel somehow you're no longer part of the world, you're ostracized from the world, that you no longer share the collective mindset of the world. It's like you've been kicked out of the club. And you feel lonely. You feel not part of it anymore. Because the whole idea of humanity is that it rests upon these taboos of a willingness to not even question the goal. And so you are not considered a human being, part of the human family, if you question these goals. You are considered persona non grata. Even worse than the social derelicts, the drug addicts, and whatever else. The human family says, "Well, you're failing, but we'll give you a pass on that." But if you question these taboos, there's no pass. There's no mercy for you. There's no mercy for you. You are persona non grata. You are excommunicated from the human family. So very few are willing to do this. Now, sometimes it's forced upon us when our suffering is so terrible that we say, "I'm sorry, but I just have to question everything because I don't understand the suffering, where it's coming from and what to do about it. And I just feel like I really need to open up every door and keep opening doors until I get an answer." And that's what happened in my case. The suffering just became completely unmanageable. And I said, I have to re-examine the fundamental premises that my mind is working off of. And in doing this, you realize that you stepped outside of the bounds of the human family, which is an ideological family. It's a family of taboos, essentially. They say, "Well, we're free to do anything we really want to do, or pretty much so, as long as we don't, cross these taboos." Problem is, these taboos are essential. I mean, they're crucial. And it may be that these taboos are actually a taboo against your freedom. So they're saying you're free to do anything you want, as long as you don't look at the basic premise, which is to believe that we're not free. It's a catch-22. It really, really is a terrible situation, actually. You're free to do whatever you want, as long as you don't realize that you're being bound and not free. Yeah, very odd. So the human family is actually running on these taboos. And these taboos, what happens is in the human family, which I am not a part of because I've been ostracized from it for so long. I don't consider myself part of the human family at all. Not really. Because it's an ideological stance, actually, and I no longer hold that stance. There's a better family, for sure. That's for sure. The family of spirit, family of truth.
And say, you know, yeah, I know the way. It's this way. Go this way, and this will work for you. And people say, oh, okay. You're smart. Okay. So the world is run by pseudo-intellectuals. And the rest of the world that follow them are very intolerant. And their stance is one of extreme intolerance, actually. Even though they're very boosterish about their tolerance, except they have extreme intolerance towards anyone who crosses these taboos to actually look in to see if the goal is even possible or desirable even. They have a virulent intolerance towards that. And yet they call themselves tolerant. This is just insanity. But it doesn't seem insane to them because they take on faith that these taboos are justified and needed. So what you might say is the human family is a family of faith in necessity of taboos. So anyone who looks at the taboos and gains certainty about, oh, I'm sure we don't need those. See, that's an anathema. That's an anathema. So never underestimate the intolerance of the human family. They may smile and boast and brag about how tolerant they are, but all the while there's this inner extreme intolerance. The more one brags about being tolerant, the more intolerant they really are. And so we have a time in this world of great braggadocio about how tolerant and how light and how progressive we're becoming. What we're really doing is becoming extremely intolerant in allowing pseudo-intellectuals to run the show here. Now there's another type of attitude that arises from these taboos, and that is one of the magicians, the ones who believe in a magical solution. They say, well, yeah, the goal isn't reachable, but we'll still reach it. There's a magical way, that there's some way to... He says, yeah, ordinarily we can't reach it. We accept that, but somehow we're going to reach it anyway. This is called the magical belief, the magicians. So there is this struggle between the intellect, pseudo-intellectuals and the magicians. The pseudo-intellectuals say, no, we'll reach it. We'll just science and technology and everything. We're gonna reach it. Don't worry. We know what we're doing. We're going to reach it. The magicians say, actually, the way you're going about it, trying to reach it, it's not going to work. But there is a way. There's not a way to reach it, but we'll reach it anyway. We'll change God's mind, so to speak. We'll change it. And so they're in conflict. These two groups are in conflict, actually. And science and religion are in conflict, actually. Because most of what religion says is, yeah, we admit that this is an impossible goal. However, God will give us a way to do it. And so, it's the same. It's not quite solved. Now, I will say that religion is more advanced than science, actually. Okay. Science and the pseudo-intellectuals say, yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we can. We can do it. Religionists say, you can't do it unless God says you can do it. But because we're such nice people, God's going to let us do it. Okay. So at least that is more advanced. Okay. Now, I know nobody's happy by what I'm saying. The scientists are saying, you're putting us down. And the religious people are saying, you're putting us down and all this. Well, what I'm saying is, I call there's five phases to solving this dilemma that we're in, actually, of trying to separate the dream from the dreamer. And you cannot just say that it's impossible because people will freak out. You have to go through these phases of looking at it. Okay. Phase one is the religious phase. The scientific and pseudo-intellectuals, they've not even started. They're still insisting that we can do it. Religion says, well, we can't do it unless God does it for us. You know, God can do it, but we can't do it. Okay. At least they've admitted, A, there is a God. B, we can't do it. Okay. These are several steps in the right direction. Then, what happens is, there's a next phase, you realize that even God can't do it. Okay. Because essentially, God cannot change God. God is not changeable. We think, oh no, God can change God. No. Now God has extended itself. There is cannot change the fact that it's all there is. God is not changeable like that. God cannot violate than order, the order of creation. Okay, but this is a very difficult step to take. Once you take this step, you're in what's called phase two. Because then you say, wow, now I really got a problem. You mean I can't, the goal's not reachable? Well, what the heck? It's like, so phase one often takes a long time because you're saying, no, I can still reach the goal. It's just, I can't do it. God will do it for me. And then when you realize you can't reach the goal, and you say, well, what good is God? You know, what good? Well, this is the question. In phase two, we start to realize how God really helps us. And we start to realize that we're so used to believing that the goal will be reached one way or the other, that we've never even considered, do we even need to reach the goal? And in phase two, we start to realize we don't need to reach the goal. We don't need to separate the dream from the dreamer. And this is a tough phase too, very tough phase. We start becoming a real intellectual, where you start to grasp the explanation intellectually. There is an explanation for all of this. It can be explained to you intellectually, yes, most definitely can. And I can definitely do this, but I have on many videos. But here we're doing an overview. Phase three is where you realize intellectually that you cannot be done. You realize that the only problem you really have is that you feel you're not good enough for reality. Reality is too good for us. That we're afraid to wake up from the dream, in other words. See, first we had the idea we have to separate the dream from the dreamer and keep the dream as permanent. So the dreamer can't stop dreaming the dream. Vanish, right? Then that's the beginning. That's the fundamental delusion. Then we take one little step, first phase, saying, well, actually, we don't have the power to change things, separate the dream from the dreamer. We don't, but God does. God has the power. So we'll appeal to God. The appeals to God don't work. And then we take another step, phase two, where we realize, wow, maybe we don't need to separate the dream from the dreamer. Maybe there's some other solution. And God actually says, yes, there is some other. There is a real solution to this. Okay, intellectually, we get it. There's a solution to it. Phase three is we start to focus more on the solution and the simplicity of it. We realize it's not so complex. You see, intellectually we think it's really difficult and complex, so I might not be able to do it. Phase three is you say, well, wait a minute, it's not so difficult. Maybe I will be able to do this. You know, just wake up from the dream. Stop dreaming the dream. Then you take one more step, phase four. And phase four is you say, I definitely can do it. And I begin to get glimpses of success. And then I realize if I just apply these simple practices, I will be able to do it. And then phase five is you do wake up from the dream. So this is an overview of the situation we're in, without getting too involved into it. We start off with zero. We take a little step, first step, second step, third step, fourth step, and then ultimately the fifth step. Now, the first step is in conflict with step zero, with the ones who have not even started. Because the pseudo-intellectuals say, yes, we can. We know the way. And the magicians say, we know the way too, which is to let God do it. And you're saying, no, humanity can do it by itself. And we're saying, no, we can separate the dream from the dreamer because God will do it for us. So they're in essential conflict there, but they still hold the same goal. So they can't let go of one another. They're in each other's way. This is the situation we have in the world, okay? Right now, we have all these first stagers, first phasers in the world, call them religious people, believing in a God who can accomplish this goal. And they say, with God, nothing's impossible. Well, it's impossible for God to change God. God cannot be, in other words, God can't get rid of God, okay? God cannot get rid of God, okay? That's impossible. God is what God is. And to separate the dream from the dreamer would be God getting rid of God. It's not possible. So you have the pseudo-intellectuals on one hand, and you have the religious people on the other hand, okay? What I've been doing is I've been calling those who are in phase 2, 3, and 4, I say, don't go back to phase 1. Don't backslide into phase 1. Now, there are many people, religious people, who are getting into phase 2. They're starting to say, hey, wait a minute. You know, that this whole dream of separating, this whole attempt to separate, it's not possible. Even God will not do that, cannot do that. We have to wake up from this nightmare, actually. I don't want to get into details of this, but what I'm saying is, don't go back to phase 1, because phase 1 is in very much in conflict with the pseudo-intellectuals. And it's head-busting time in the world now. The pseudo-intellectuals want nothing better than to get rid of the phase 1ers, or the religious people. Because, they have the same goal, but the means are completely different. And the pseudo-intellectuals just hate the phase 1ers. You know, and the phase 1ers look down upon the pseudo-intellectuals, saying, you know, your way is never going to work. And the pseudo-intellectuals say, your God that you're praying to is not going to do anything for you. It never has and never will. Well, they have a point, because God cannot get rid of God. But, of course, the pseudo-intellectuals believe that we must do this, separate the dream from the dreamer. That's not true. We don't need to do it. So they're fundamentally mistaken about the need for it. So both of them have some leverage, you see. They both have some leverage. But right now the pseudo-intellectuals have more leverage, because they say, look, you've been trying for thousands of years. You've been praying to this God, saying that God will give you the answers. Never gave us the answers. It's only science that has given us the answers. It made life better for us here and all this. So they have the media. They have the means of persuasion in the world right now. So their goal is to get rid of religious people, for sure. And allow the form of religion without the content. Okay, they realize they cannot immediately get rid of religious people and all religion. But what their aim is to fundamentally, ideologically gut the religion of their core beliefs and allow formal ritual stuff, the form of it, but not the content. So they're in a head-busting mode right now, for sure. I saw this in a dream. They went after the religious right, for example, in the United States. And I was looking at this dream as an observer in all this. Now, the pseudo-intellectuals don't go after the second, third, and fourth phasers. No, they can't, because they can't. Not really. They're no match for them. We just dismiss them like a fly. Because we're not asking God to do the impossible for us, you see. So we don't have these issues. So I was just observing. I was observing in this dream, and I saw what happened. And the pseudo-intellectuals have gained the upper hand. Now, they went after the Christian right, the religious right in this country. And I was saying, who do they think they are? They're asking for trouble doing that. You know, they don't have the capacity to take down the religious right. And so I watched what happened, and I was very surprised. Is they did take down the religious right, and they were very vicious about it, ruthless. They're more organized than we imagine. Although the Christian right has been monitoring they realize that they're being targeted for sure, and they've been monitoring all the different moves that the pseudo intellectuals have been making, and so they're very aware that, you know, there is this huge buildup towards them. And a lot of people are not aware of how much has been done, but so much has been done that what I saw was they took them down. And then I saw them, they were almost unconscious, and they tried to put their head in a swimming pool, try to drown them or something like that. I'm not sure about what that was, why they were trying to do that. But let us just say, it was aggressive to an extreme extent. I was quite shocked by this, the aggression. So, now, the question is, where does one's loyalties... Well, loyalty is the truth. Okay, loyalty is the truth. Otherwise, it's meaningless. It's not loyalty, it's tabooism. We don't want to keep on with the religion of tabooism. Now, the pseudo-intellectuals say it's taboo to even question their capacity to reach this goal. The phase oneers say it's taboo to even question God's capacity to reach this goal. So they're both running on taboos instead of truth. So this is the question that we have. Certainly, when I was leaving the scene in the dream, and I saw this tower, black tower, square black tower, rising up so high. It was a colossal skyscraper. And up near the top were the network people, the media network people. And those are the ones who yelled out to me as I was leaving, "What time is it? What time is it? Tell everybody what time it is." And I looked at my watch, and time was just changing back and forth. Changing time is time of drastic change. Time of drastic change. And people living under this massive black skyscraper, those are the ones who believe that the goal can be reached, and pseudo-intellectualism and science and technology will enable it to be reached. And as far as I can tell, the Christian right is going to be wiped out. So it certainly is not was never the goal of any teacher here to claim that you're supposed to believe that God can accomplish the impossible, that God can get rid of God. The nature of reality is God. Reality cannot be changed. You cannot separate the dreamer from the dream. The dreamer is dreaming. You cannot do that. It's impossible. And then I did see these wildcats coming into the world, and again, the world is going to become very animalistic, In other words, we're not even intelligent enough to question the goal of the pseudo-intellectuals, right? We go along like sheep, like goats, like cow, like cattle. The goal is to make us very animalistic, so it's easy for the pseudo-intellectuals to control the agenda here. They don't want religion returning, you see. Because religion is actually, as I said, it's an actual stage, a phase of salvation. It's phase one. So, to that extent, it's a necessary step, but you can't stay in that step because you're inherently in conflict with the pseudo-intellectuals. Of course, the goal of religion is to get everybody on the planet agreeing with them. Just same goal as the pseudo-intellectuals. They want everyone to agree so their position isn't threatened. They feel if everyone doesn't agree, then their position could be threatened. And they feel at all costs they must maintain the dream. Okay, this is the whole point of this situation is the belief by the pseudo-intellectuals and the religious people is that at all costs this dream must be maintained. That literally this is our reality. This dream is our reality. And so the idea of a dreamer of this dream is incredibly threatening. They say we must get rid of this dreamer or separate the dream from the dreamer so the dreamer can't end the dream because we need this dream. We feel this dream is reality. This is our home. It's the only home we have. Why? Because we feel that reality is too good for us, that we wouldn't fit in there. Now, this is the underlying greater issue, is we feel we wouldn't fit in with reality, and therefore the dream's the only home we have, and we must maintain it. So, the intellect can see this. So a true intellectual is able to see this, working with reason. A real intellect works with reason. Pseudo-intellect works with taboos, false premises. So the real problem is we feel we wouldn't fit in to reality. Reality's too good for us. We just wouldn't feel like we belong. Okay, we wouldn't feel like we belong. This is the real problem. So the religious people, they keep insisting, no, don't. God will separate the dream from the dreamer and make this world a beautiful place, and we won't have to go home. We'll make this our new home. God will do that for us. That's their belief, basically. Pseudo-intellectuals say, no, we'll make it a permanent home for us by science and technology. We don't need any God. God that can change this world doesn't exist. Stop believing that something can happen just by wishing it. So, all right, so there's a big conflict there. Now, they have the upper hand because God cannot change the world, really. Well, let's put it this way. God cannot separate the dream from the dreamer. That's impossible. Now, the dreamer can change the dream, that is true. But the problem is that the dreamer is so scared of not having the dream, it doesn't want to be even reminded of what it's like to not dream. Okay, so it wants to keep the dream very different from reality, very different. The problem is it can't stand this dream because it's so different from reality. So it's this catch-22. And that's when we feel so vulnerable. The dreamer says, wait a minute. I really need to separate this dream from the dreamer. There's got to be a separation here. And the dream has to be autonomous. So we've dreamed this dream of nature. And we feel that somehow nature is autonomous. And it's just like this Autobot that automatically, keeps doing everything. And we believe that we don't even need a God or a dreamer of the dream. That the dream just perpetuates itself without any dreamer. This is not true. But we certainly interpret it that way. Upon the one that is dreaming them, one that is desiring them entirely. But we choose to say no to this. We choose to turn away from this and say, no, nature is automatic and doesn't need any dreamer. The pseudo-intellects say that. The religious people say, no, God is the one behind nature, and God will always sustain it and keep it, because God, it's God's creation, so it's eternal. See, this is not true. But this is just another way to try and insist that it's eternal. But to say it's God's creation really is to say that we've been able to separate the dream from the dreamer. And the real dreamer is spirit. It's not God, it's spirit. Now, spirit technically is God, but is an extension of God. And the one thing the spirit can't do is change God, you see. It cannot. And this is where we get into deeper territory. And we don't have to jump into that right at this moment. So part of the way of the path is to realize you don't have to jump in over your head. You can back away like this. Says, wait a minute, let me just get a little more stable where I'm at. You see, the pseudo-intellectual wants to force the issue and prove how smart it is, whereas the real intellect says, wait, I need to manage my success appropriately here. So I know I'm being very successful here, so don't let me, like, get in too far. That's like you're swimming in the pool, and then you start going out in the deep end. You suddenly get worried. You say, whoa, wait a minute. I'm not that good at swimming yet. It's like you back off a little bit. You just back off. So the water's a little too deep there. We have a tree. We have a tree out front where we have a tree that seems to get sick a lot, and it seems to reflect the times in the world in some way. It's very interesting. The tree is a memorial tree we planted for my dad. He's a very intuitive person, and he could understood what was coming and was very much in tune with spirit in a lot of ways. That tree is a memorial tree for him. It's always been sick, and recently it's gotten so bad that I had to start trimming it, because it was just like dying. It was totally infested with horrible scale and black darkness, and all the branches are coated with this horrible dark sooty. It's just whole ghastly. And I was thinking, you know what? It's not really going to live. It's just so sick, the tree. And finally this morning I cut it down. Tough to do. This is my dad's memorial tree. But I realized my dad was somehow giving us a sign, saying, look, things are now irreversibly terrible. Irreversibly terrible. The sickness was, you know, basically irreversible. It is better to replant. Better to replant. Way better to replant. Healthy soil, healthy plant. Replant. This thing, you could try and scrub it and work on it feverishly, and maybe, you know, in several years of work, you know, might start coming back a little bit. But it's feeble. It's very feeble. It's, you know, and it's an eyesore, and it's terrible. And I said, you know, there's certain times you just need to cut your losses. I finally cut it down. So you replant. So what happens is when phase one doesn't get into phase two enough, this allows the pseudo-intellectualism, like a parasite, to get a hold of the world. And you can't keep yelling, Jesus, 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 separate the dream from the dreamer, because Jesus can't do that. You say, oh, Jesus, you can do anything. If I keep praying to you, you can do it. Jesus can't change God. God can't change God. God cannot get rid of God. Separating the dream from the dreamer would mean God would get rid of God. So you cannot forever just say, Jesus, 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 do the impossible. And then just wait. Because if you do that, the pseudo-intellectuals are eventually going to begin to gain momentum. Okay. So that they have gained momentum, not just gained momentum here, they are in control. So what I decided was it's a lost cause. This tree is a lost cause. It, you know, there's still some green leaves on it, I understand. And I could just keep trimming it back and back, but it's never going to be a robust tree. It is never, it's always going to be sickly in the situation. It's better to replant. This time, dig a big old hole, put in tremendously, we didn't do that for this time. We did not, we dug a hole, but it wasn't big enough. We didn't put in good soil. We just didn't do it right. Okay. Next time, we're going to dig a hole that's, you know, 6 feet wide and 6 feet deep. We're going to put in the finest mixture, blend of soil imaginable. We're going to fertilize it, right? And we're going to make this tree just, you know, awesomely robust. Awesomely robust. So you learn through what's happened, and all these people who have been stuck in the first phase for so long are certainly going to regret it that they got stuck. They can't go back to pseudo-intellectualism, and yet they feel stuck. They can't move forward to true intellectualism. They're still looking for a magical solution. They can't go forward with reason. And so they feel stuck, and so they feel like fighting. Now in that dream I saw, the religious right was very belligerent towards the police. That's very defiant, very defiant. So they were ready for the fight too. They were ready for the fight. And so the fight ensued. Later on, as we know, there is no secure outcome when you try to do the impossible. Death is not a secure outcome at all. Death is part of the dream, actually, that we're dreaming. It's not a secure outcome. So at some time, those who have been stuck in this phase one will find themselves again presented with the situation, opportunity to keep working to get into phase two. Once you get into phase two, you have the momentum. You're starting to be robust. The tree becomes robust. Right now it's sickly, very sickly. You cannot just put this magical solution on death and say, yeah, when I die, everything will be great. You know, that's not the answer. Death is not a secure outcome whatsoever. We just say, well, it doesn't matter anymore that I failed. Oh, yes, it does. Because you haven't given up the dream. You know, death is simply part of the dream that we're dreaming. So it doesn't do anything to end the dream. So they're going to get whacked, and then they're going to say, wow. Maybe both sides will finally say, wow, this isn't it. Both sides will come to a conclusion. The pseudo-intellects will say, even though I defeated these God people believe in God, I still feel like I can't do it, really. And the others will say, even we got defeated, but God did not save us from this, and so we can't put our trust into that belief in God, that God can do the impossible. And then they may decide, we better start taking a look at this more deeply. Let's actually take a look here. Let's actually inquire all the way here. Let's really re-examine the situation in its entirety. That's phase two. You start in phase two as a re-examination in its entirety of the whole situation. Then phase three, you start coming to conclusions. Phase four is final summation. Phase five, you're finished. You no more need for any dream. No more need for any dream of separation. Any more, no more dream need for that. But again, that's detail. We don't really want to jump into that. It's too deep for us right now. So we are in a time of drastic change. We are in a time when there is will be conflict. The whole purpose of this resolution, the United Nations resolution, is the pseudo-intellectual setting up this, the infrastructure to whack the religious right, for sure. They're just using ISIS as a convenient excuse. Very convenient excuse, yes. But their aim is much further than ISIS, that is for sure. It's to get rid of people who believe that God can work miracles here. And of course, the miracles that God can work is the miracle of truth, is a miracle of accepting that God cannot get rid of God, that it's impossible to separate from God. No separation can take place. So if you want to call that miracles, yes, but not God cannot do the miracle of transforming the dream, separating the dream from the dreamer and making it permanent outside, without any, you know, without the dreamer having anything to do with it. It's not possible. But scientists, the two intellectuals want to get rid of that mindset because they say it doesn't work. How does that work to transform the world? They say, how? No, it doesn't do anything, right? You're just waiting and wishing and hoping. They say, we want to get action going here. Let's cure illnesses. Let's do all this. You know, so they're very much activist. They think the way of just sitting there, God, I'm praying to God, praying, says it doesn't work. We want what works. Let's get rid of you. Of course, transforming the world, there are no secure outcomes in a dream, are there? Are there any secure outcomes in a dream? This is ultimately the question you must ask yourself. Are there any secure outcomes in a dream? This is something to contemplate on. Cannot the dreamer change the dream in any way they want to? So how can there be a secure outcome in a dream? Is anything secure in a dream? Is an outcome? This is the question you must ask yourself. So this whole goal, let's transform this world and all this stuff, well, that's very nice, but you're trying to find a secure outcome. Is there a secure outcome in the dream? There's not. So it doesn't matter how neat and nice and the vineyards are. It's not a secure. Did you secure an outcome in the dream? No. What we're trying to do is what science and technology is trying to do is to secure an outcome. And then by inference, pseudo-intellectualism, say that because we have a secure outcome, that means we achieved our goal, we separated the dream from the dreamer. You see, it wants to use reverse logic like that. So what it will do is we'll just define some outcome as secure. And then use that as a faith to say, okay, on faith, they will take it on faith. And then it's actually a type of religion. Science and technology is actually a religion. It's religion of insanity. And reverse logic, reversing region. So they say, okay, by faith, we will say that we have a secure outcome. We've secured this outcome. This outcome is secure. Therefore, we reason from this premise that we must have separated the dream from the dreamer. Otherwise, it wouldn't be secure. And see, we succeeded. But you say, well, wait a minute. This, what you're saying is a secure outcome. Is that a fact or is that faith? Or is it just a belief? And let's look, is it really secure? Yeah, and then you get to the emperor has no clothes type of thing where nobody dares say it's not. So you run into an ideological dictatorship, the pseudo-intellectuals. It ends up in this hive mind that nobody dare question the central premise that we've secured. We have a secure outcome. The pseudo-intellectuals are always saying, let's kill all the intellectuals, you know. Those who don't have enough faith in our pronouncements. We have pronounced that we have secured an outcome. The real intellectuals say, no, wait a minute, let's take a closer look at this. Oh, no, you can't do that. So is there a road that leads away from all this? Absolutely, there's a road that leads away from all this. Leads through the hills. Some sort of foothill thing that you go in the hills that take you away from this. They're not lofty mountains, it's not too high up, but it's higher than the skyscraper. You leave it behind. Now, it doesn't really matter what happens in this dream at all, because the basic facts of awakening from it are always the same. Phase 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is you simply begin questioning the taboos, abandoning magical belief, realizing what the big picture is, that you cannot achieve such separation, accepting that God is not the one that is dreaming the dream, realizing we don't need the dream. You know, it's all the same. So it doesn't really matter what form the confusion takes, or what kind of madcap stratagems are being pursued. One simply has to go through this process of setting it down. That's all. Whatever it is, it's the same. So there's no reason to monitor the situation, say, okay, exactly what's happening. It doesn't matter. God isn't dreaming the dream. The dream cannot be separated from the dreamer. God cannot change this the facts of reality. Always the same. The facts are always the same. So those who are in denial of facts always have the same way of going through these phases to gradually accept facts. That's all. It doesn't matter what form the denial takes. It does not matter. Because saying, well, this form of denial of truth is better than this form is meaningless. So there's no meaningful difference, really. Well, phase one is saying, hey, there's someone who can help us. We have some help. Jesus is the help, or Buddha is the help, whatever. There's some way that can help us, etc. Well, that's true. That is true. But the help is not magical help. So you have to mature out of phase one. And right now, phase oneers are so angry at the pseudo-intellectuals for basically the pseudo-intellectuals calling their bluff, so to speak. And the pseudo-intellectuals look down on the religious people as if they're insane. But they're not quite insane. They believe there is a God, the creator of all, so to speak. Creator of allness, actually. And two, they believe that God does send help. Three, they believe the grace of God helps us. So there's a lot of elements that they're correct about. It's just that all these elements will not accomplish magic for them, will not accomplish the impossible. So basically they say, yes, there is help, and this help is going to help me do the impossible. And that is not true. which is why they feel that death will save them. Because they're saying, wow, I just can't quite get there. Even God does not let me get there, so it must be, they say, it must be that when I die, I'll get there. No, it doesn't work. Now, I remember when I, what helped me was to realize my past lives, and I realized death is not a secure outcome. It didn't solve the problem for me. And that's when I got really intensely determined, because I knew death will never solve the problem. See, we keep thinking that for some reason, the reason why God can't accomplish this impossible, separate the dream from the dreamer, is because we're living. We have this body. And once we're dead, that's like the price we need to pay, and then God will say, oh, okay, now I'll do it for you. Now I'll do it for you. We've just made this up. It's like a bargain, you know? It's kind of like when you want something from somebody, say, oh, look at that nice bicycle or something. Can I have that? And someone says, no, it's mine. And so what do we think? Say, well, I really want it. So I'll tell you what, I will pay you for the bike. Okay. They say, no, I really like the bike. I'll pay you a lot for it. You know, well, how much? Well, you know, how much do you want? Says, well, I want something very valuable. Okay. I'll give you something real valuable, and then I get the bike. So we go to God, say, God, please separate the dream from the dreamer. And God said, I can't do that. And we say, okay, God must be saying he doesn't want to. He's trying to bargain with us. So we say, okay, God, what do you want from me in order to do this? And God says, oh, I can't do it. We say, wow, God's driving a hard bargain here. I'll tell you what, God, I will give you what I feel is most valuable. I'll give you my life. Okay. And that then will secure the deal, right? And of course, thing is, God says, no. And we say, oh, you just don't believe me that I'll do it, but I'll prove to you I'll do it. So imagine if we went up to somebody. Let's say they have a house, very nice house. And we say, well, we want to buy your home. And they say, it's not for sale. And they say, well, what's your price? And they say, well, I don't have a price. It's not for sale. And we say, okay. How much? Okay, I'll tell you what. I'm just going to arbitrarily decide what the selling price is for you, because I know you're going to sell it to me. It's just you're trying to get the maximum price. So I'm going to give you the maximum price. You know, I'm going to give you $10 billion for your home. Deal. Okay, and then you turn away. You don't even look to see whether they agree or not. You say, that's reasonable. So I'm going to go with that. So we have said to God, okay, we're going to give our lives, God, and to you, sacrifice our lives to you, and in return, you're going to separate the dream from the dreamer for us. Whether you like to or not, we've just decided that you have to accept this offer. We've never looked to see if God has accepted. We just insist, oh yes, God has accepted this offer for sure. Has not. God is not, there's no deal to be made. But we say, well, God's reasonable, and we made a reasonable offer, therefore God must have accepted it. It's true, God is reasonable. And first step of reason is to say the impossible cannot be accomplished, that no matter what is offered. So, you see, offering our lives to God like this, saying, okay, you're trying to get a deal, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. And when you realize you've tried it over and over and never, it doesn't work, then you say, wow, now I really feel stuck. Holy, now I really got to dig into this. And this is what happened to me. I realized death doesn't work. Death does not work at all. And then you say, shoot, I'm going to be living in this dream, this hell forever then, unless I figure out how to get out of it. I'm stuck here for good, unless I've got to find the true resolution of this, if there is one. And so that gets you going. If prior to that, I was still, you know, not really committed. But once I saw that, I became very committed right away. I just knew, says, I'm stuck in this stance that I have forever, unless I resolve it, truly resolve it. And death will never resolve it for me, so I have to come to a genuine resolution. And that began the spiritual path. That really pushed me into phase two. Phase two is you realize death doesn't, the deal you make, you insisted that God accept, doesn't work. God doesn't accept it. Now, this is, of course, a fundamental belief in much of the world, is that we can make a deal with God. And we believe that if we make, just give what's, we believe the deal is there, and so we believe by giving the ultimate sacrifice, that has to complete the deal. We just simply, by reason, we say it has to complete the deal. But our premise is wrong. Our premise is that the deal is there to be made. That's a false premise. Because we're thinking that it must be made, you see. That we need to have it made, it has to be made. So therefore we claim it must be there. Now what I discovered is the deal's not there, and we don't have to make it. We've just been imagining it's there because we thought we needed to, we have to. And what you discover eventually is that is the stance of hallucination, of a hallucinator, is what we're suffering from. Where what we're hallucinating, when one hallucinates, they see something there, and instead of saying, "Hey, I'm hallucinating," they say, "Hey, wait a minute. Now, oh, how come I didn't see that before? So this is true, huh?" And then they say, "Well, what I've seen before must have been false. And if that was false, then I couldn't have come from that. I couldn't. My identity can't be based on what's false. So my identity must be based on what I'm hallucinating right now." And then, of course, they become terrified that they may stop hallucinating. So what do? Try to separate the hallucination from the hallucinator, the dream from the dreamer. This is the whole issue, the entire issue. And you're terrified of the hallucinator who will stop hallucinating because the hallucinator thinks they will cease to exist if that happens, thinking that its identity, its reality is now based on what it's hallucinating. So we can't go to God and say, "God, this is terrible. You know, if I stop hallucinating, I'll be annihilated." Because God will say, no, you won't. You'll just wake up and realize you're just hallucinating and you're perfectly included in the totality. God knows that. If God were to say, oh yeah, I really need to separate hallucinator from hallucination, then God will be essentially saying to the hallucinator that you're right, that what you saw before, reality, was all a dream. And then therefore God will be saying that it's a dream. God's a dream. God cannot be a dream. You see? This is reason. This is true reason, which is based on true premise. Pseudo-intellectuals use a false premise and then believe they can arrive at a right conclusion. And so they're very, you can tell they have a fake confidence. You know, it's kind of they just say, "Hey, how dare you question me? You know, I'm so superior to you that it's obvious I know the answer, so don't even bother asking me." and they get control of all the bureaucracy and all the power and all this stuff, so they can insulate themselves, make sure nobody even dare questions their, you know, probity, how right they are. So I would suggest that as much as possible, keep working to get into phase two. This is where safety is. Okay. So I'm not a hater of phase one at all. I'm saying you have to get into phase two. You have to take Jesus and grace and the Holy Spirit and God and all of this and set it all on the right premise. Because if God did what you're asking God to do, God would be saying that God is actually a dream. It's unreal. And then, if God agreed with this, what hope would you ever have to? It would be complete annihilation of God. Everything, you know, God can't do that. So, you have no choice but to take the path, take your cross, and walk the Via Dolorosa, you know, the way of sorrows, which is the burden of overcoming your fears and insecurities. We do have an extreme insecurity, an extreme continuity fear, extreme insecurity leading to extreme continuity fear. Ultimately, we realize that this is all nonsense as far as us ceasing to exist. So we really end up with a continuity fear, like, wow, reality's too good for me. I could never return there to reality after being so stupid. You know, I'm scarred. I'm branded forever. I'm unworthy. I'm not worthy. But a lot of this unworthiness thing is just a fear-based, right? It's fear-based thing. I'm still afraid of the abyss. So I say our real problem is the continuity problem. Our pseudo problem is this stance of hallucination making us think that we'd cease to exist. So we certainly need to be aware of what the pseudo problem is. Because when we see that, we're still left with a continuity problem. We still say, okay, I see this, but I'm afraid of glory. You know, I'm afraid of perfection. So we're still stuck with that. So it's very important to recognize a continuity problem. Otherwise, in seeing the truth, you'll still feel afraid, and you say, well, that couldn't have been it then. Okay, couldn't have been it. Yes, it was it. But then it leaves us with a continuity problem. So I feel the continuity problem is essential to get through phase two and phase three, is to recognize that it's working, but it's bringing up this continuity issue. As we make progress, we're still afraid. And we think, wow, why am I still afraid? I should be happy. I'm liberated. And no. We see, oh God, this dance of hallucination, this led me into this desperate, terrible situation. I see it's all bogus, and you know, but I'm scared, and still scared. So the fear is, it doesn't magically dissipate. It's still there, but it's continuity fear. It's very important. What I've seeing Jesus in A Course in Miracles actually says your real problem is this issue of continuity. You think you'll be catapulted back into reality. You're terrified of it. So you desperately cling to delusion. That's the real fear. That is the real fear. So this has to be acknowledged. Otherwise, we won't make progress. Because we'll say, wait a minute. I tried to make progress. I still feel frightened. What is that? Well, we did make progress. But now we get the jitters, like, oh my gosh, maybe I made so much progress, I'm going to be suddenly the glory of reality will dawn upon me. You know, vision of oneness will just dawn upon me, like, oh, I'll just be rapturously happy, and it's too much, you know. So that's the continuity fear. So that continuity fear always accompanies our progress. So this is crucial. Otherwise, we'll interpret progress as bringing up fear. We'll say, turn back, you know, go back to phase one, magical belief, or pseudo-intellectualism, one of the two. But religious people hate pseudo-intellectuals because they know there is a God, you see. And the pseudo-intellectuals say there is no God. And so, you know, once you experience God, you're never going to deny God, okay? So the religious people cannot go back to pseudo-intellectualism, not really. Maybe the pseudo-religionists will go back to it, but the real religious people, they cannot, because they have experienced something within them that they realize there is a God. There is glory, there is a God, and yet they misinterpret, they still think, therefore, this God can be appealed to accomplish the impossible for me. It's like that, you see. But they cannot go back. They cannot go back. So the pseudo-intellectuals simply have to trying to read a crystal ball, you know, in the future here. Well, the pseudo-intellectuals realize they can't win. They can't get people to abandon their religion, so that's why they want to get rid of them, snuff them out. That's what they want to do. And it will probably come as a shock to them at some point, like, wow, we had to resort to this. And they'll feel like a sense of inadequacy, impotency. Like they said, I should have been able to convince them. You know, they say, I should have been able to convince them, and my intellect was not sufficient, and it will bother them greatly. And then they'll want to say, try to understand the religious people. So if I could just understood them better, I could have convinced them that they were crazy, but I wasn't able to convince them, so we had to use aggression. You see, the pseudo-intellectuals don't really like using aggression. They want to convince others, persuade, advertise, market, propagandize. See, that's what they're after. And the fact that they fail will be really a sore point for them going forward. It will gnaw at them, you know. A great defeat for them, actually. Great defeat. So both sides will be greatly defeated. The religious people feel God did not help them and feel forsaken. The pseudo-intellectuals will feel that their intellect was not sufficient to persuade, and they'll feel inept, and as if that the, you know, great defeat for them. So both sides are actually be very defeated. And out of that will come a resurrection of interest, genuine interest in path of salvation. So it is important that there are those who have taken the path and can reassure everyone, say, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. This situation eventually will, this double defeat will eventuate in something very positive. Well, if it's going to be a double defeat here, actually. Sort of a no-win situation. But ultimately it'll be a win-win. Be a win-win. Swords will be melted down into plowshares, so to speak. The lion will lie down with the lamb, so to speak. Both sides very chastened by what will happen. So there's a great chastening coming upon the world, a great tribulation coming upon the world. Lose-lose situation. And for those who see this, then they need to set up a situation where that can accommodate this change of heart, change of mind in all these spirits that are engaged in this. They can say, hey, there has to be a better way. There has to be a better way than this. And then, yes, there is a better way. But it's an ordeal. But it's better than nothing, you know. Better than nothing. So, okay. What to do? What to do next? This is the question. The light can die because the religious people say, hey, you know, God can do anything. And we say, no, God cannot get rid of God. And they say, well, we weren't asking God to do that. I said, yes, you were. You're asking for the fundamental nature of reality to be extinguished. That separating, you know, spirit from what it is experiencing. That's like separating God from itself. It cannot be done. So, you know, you were asking for God to accomplish the impossible. That's the problem. So don't throw out God, just ask God, God, do the possible, which is bring me back to sanity. And God will say, absolutely, there's a way for that. Now ultimately, now we talk about phase 1, 2, 3, 4. What's phase 5? Phase 5 is the realization that that all our efforts of the path do not generate an outcome. They don't add up to an outcome. The outcome is to realize that no outcome needs to be generated. That we never left reality. This is the awakening. This is the awakening. So the question of gradualism compared to radical, sudden awakening it is easy to resolve, and that you have to we're so accustomed to just junk gradualism. So what we have to do is we have to gradually get used to the idea that gradualism does not result in any outcome whatsoever. There are no outcomes in reality. There's only the pure functioning of reality. So there's not really a conflict between those two viewpoints, and people have gotten stagnated in this, and which has allowed pseudo-intellectuals to take over here. And someone said, you know, people say, well, yeah, the Tibetan Buddhists are embroiled in this huge debate, and the Christians are, you know, religions get into these, Sunnis and Shias are, you know, they get embroiled in these conflicts, debates. What is the succession? Do we elect the successor, or by, you know, is it direct descendants, you know, or what is the position, suddenism or gradualism? And all this stuff stagnates you in phase one. It's all an expression of your continuity fear, actually. You're saying, I'm too scared to go any further. Too scared. Now, the answer is you go very carefully. You know, and the thing is you still don't want to seem to be stupid to the pseudo-intellectuals. You want to prove to them your God is a mighty God, you see. And here you are, like, crawling along so carefully and slowly, and the intellectuals are laughing at you and saying, what happened to your mighty God, you know? And you say, well, my God is mighty, but I made a mighty mistake also. You see, I made a mighty mistake, and now I have a mighty continuity problem. So I need to go real slow here, because I really have such a severe continuity issue. It doesn't mean that my God isn't mighty, almighty, but my continuity fear is an issue that has to be resolved very carefully and gently, or else I'll go back into a defensive posture. So you really have to sort of stay away from intellectuals, is what I found out. I had to stay away from intellectuals, pseudo-intellectuals, I'm sorry. I just didn't have anything more to do with them, because surely they would mock you, for sure. And Jesus said, you'll be mocked on the path, of course. They'll just laugh and say, hey, where's your mighty God now? Look at you crawling on the ground. How ridiculous you are. You see, there is no God, you see? That's what the thief, the murderer, on Jesus' side said, hey, Jesus, you see, there is no God. Your God isn't saving you. You're a liar and a deceiver, and spitting at Jesus and cursing him, you know, saying, look, see, save yourself. Where's your mighty God now? Right? And Jesus' death is symbolic of the death of the continuity fear. And the resurrection, getting through that process, you know, the way of sorrows and the ultimate death of the continuity fear, death of the dream, I mean, the death of the idea that the dream can produce an outcome. And the thief, the other one on this other side said, hey, okay, I get it. And Jesus says, all right, that's all you need to do. You get it. So the pseudo-intellectuals most certainly will mock you to try and substantiate their position. There is no God, they believe. There's only nature, they think. Only nature. Nature is their God. And I'd say, why study nature? It's not a secure outcome at all. There's nothing secure about nature whatsoever. So why waste time studying it? You know, it's ridiculous. Why waste time studying a dream or measuring the dream and analyzing the dream? It's just a dream. It's not you can't secure any outcome at all. You can't secure any data at all, actually. You can't say, this is the way that it is. This is the way a dream is. No, the dream is completely at the mercy of the dreamer. So basically what Jesus told us, you have to put up with that, you know, the pseudo-intellectual spitting at you and laughing at you and cursing you and mocking you and all this stuff. You have to be very humble It's not fun. That's not fun. And basically, you have to be very quiet. I don't discuss this information with pseudo-intellectuals at all because they can't handle it. Yeah, at all. They'll say, well, where's your God? How come God hasn't saved you? You know? Because of the continuity problem. Too frightened to be pulled into reality. I still feel I don't belong there. So it would freak me out. See, that's the answer. So if you have this answer for the pseudo-intellectuals, you know, they'll leave you alone. I still think, oh, what an idiot. You know, thought God was saving and hadn't done anything. What an idiot. So you just have to say, okay, say what you want. Well, but it's better, again, don't poke the hornet's nest of the pseudo-intellectuals. Don't try to convert them, you know. They got too many issues going on. So somehow, you know, out of this conflict that's coming up, both sides will feel very defeated, very deflated, very deflated. It's amazing. You reach some point where what you thought before was so great is just gone. Because actually, it was a hope that made everything look wonderful. Like, I was out on a golf course and suddenly it all lost its charm entirely. It was amazing. I just looked around and I said, my God, what am I doing here? No charm at all. And so there's just something. What happened was I had explored every area, all these off the beaten track, way down this hill or around this stony area. And I've been everywhere there. And I realized I've been everywhere here. And so I know everywhere here, and then suddenly the charm just vanished. The same thing in relationships. You know everything there is about to know about the person, and suddenly the charm is gone. Just, you say, wow. Because you keep thinking you're hoping you're gonna find something, the answer. Find what you want. And when you realize you've looked everywhere and you didn't find it, it's just like the charm vanishes. And once it vanishes, it's like, holy God, it's like death or something. It's just, there's nothing here I want. So both sides will realize, there's nothing here I want. The charm is gone. All right. So we need to focus forward somehow at this point in time. We'll see what can happen. Need to focus forward. The picture's been set. Conflict is on. Both sides will lose. There's going to be a great need then for rehabilitation. And we have to start working on setting up how we're going to help everybody who are desperate for rehabilitation. There has to be a fundamental movement towards rehabilitation on a cosmic scale, involving other dwelling places, other planets, large rehabilitation, halfway houses. All of this needs to be staffed, set up, staffed, and all that. So this is a bigger overview of the plan of salvation. It doesn't involve just this planet. It involves other dwelling places, other births, other lives, becoming upon teachers, coming upon better teaching, better curriculum, becoming upon very much a trickle-down enlightenment, so to speak, in where you are. And there's a lot to it. So somehow we have to focus forward at this point. Focus forward at this point and look at the real big picture. Don't worry about these conflicts. However it turns out, both sides are losers. Okay? All right, that's it for now. Focus forward.